2013 parenting site, you'll see 24 writers that write on everything from foster parenting to faith formation to single parenting to anything and everything in between. It's a one-stop shop, and we have been so incredibly blessed to have the team that we have. Today for you, we have four members of our team, along with Lori and Ian.
There's no way, because they're all different. We respond to each one of our children individually. All right, we may have some overarching expectations and attitudes, morals, values, faith, but individually we interact with our kids differently, just as God does with each one of us.
Yes.
We need to bring kindness into our home. Kindness and respect go hand in hand. If you treat someone with kindness, you are going to find that respect follows. Kindness cements our families together, you guys. We all want strong families, yes? We all want strong families. We want our kids to be friends when we're gone, yeah? We do. We want our families cemented together. The only way that that is going to happen is when we are kind. God is referred to as both kind and stern. Okay? So you can be kind and still have your household rules. You can be kind and still have the guidelines and your values. Just because you might not agree with someone doesn't mean you have to be unkind. We become a culture as if we don't agree with each other, you can't love somebody. Well, that's a Scripture talks specifically against that. Love your enemies. It's a greater love to love somebody who's not agreeing with you than to love someone who's easy to love and agrees with everything you say. Okay? Kindness is huge. I was working with one.
Those individual gifts that God has given them. So that's one example. Here's another one. Start with a pie pan, some pieces of paper. We talk to kids about sin in their life. We have this activity where we throw balls at a target. You hit the target, we go, yay! You missed the target, everybody in the family yells, sin! Because that's the big theological definition of sin. Go to seminary, what does sin mean? Missing the target. Okay, so I want to teach them what sin means. It means missing the target. So we play that game. One weekend I say, that target represents God's will for our life. He's told us in his word the kind of words we should use, the kind of thoughts we should have. When we do what God wants us to do, it's hitting that target. But when we do what we want to do ahead of what God would have us do, that's missing the target, and that's sin. So now we come to the next week. I have this pie pan. I start with this pie pan and some pieces of paper. And I talk to the kids about individual sins they struggle with. So my son, when he was really young, he struggled with using the word stupid. He knew he wasn't supposed to use the word stupid, but when he got mad, what word do you think he liked to use? Stupid. So how does that parent go? He's fired up, he's using the word, you go up to him and say, if you use that word one more time, and now my son, love that boy, you look right at me and go, stupid, stupid, stupid. All right? So now not only do you have the bad word, but you got an attitude problem. But here we are in family time, and I go, you struggle with using that word, you know you're not supposed to use it. Turns to me and he says, I know, Dad, I'll try not to. What? Why would I get that response? Because he's not fired up. He knows we're all going to have fun. He knows we're all going to share something. My daughter, she was dealing with some different issues. I walked by her bedroom. I'm not even sure why we bought this girl dressers. There's clothes on the floor. There's clothes on the bed. They're all over the place. Honey, you need to clean up your room. Dad, I'll do that right away. What a sweet, wonderful response. 20 minutes later, I walk by, she's nowhere in sight. Maddie, Dad, I'm on my way, I told her to take that. 20 minutes later, I look in there, total chaos around her, she's dealing with something small. So, she's working on obedience. As a parent, you might want to share some things you struggle with. You spilled that glass of water last night and grounded you for 3 months. I think I overreacted, I'm working on that, sorry about that, okay? So you end up with a pie pan filled with your sins. The jar of water represents us. And in this object lesson, the egg represents God. So you can see in a very clear way, if we're the jar of water and God's the egg, what separates us from God? We're sin. So what we need is we need a sin buster. We need somebody who can come into our life, take away the sin, so that we can be back together with God. Now, who do you think could be our sin buster? Jesus. Jesus, represented by this broom, I'll write write Jesus on a piece of masking tape, put it on the top of the room, is our sin buster. So when Jesus comes into our life, he takes away the sin so that we can be back together with God. There's the gospel in the language of children.
When we first got married, we were so in love. They start thinking about marriage like a new car. You know when you get that new car, you bring it home, and it's shiny, and everything's perfect on it. It's got that new car smell. The paint looks great, and all the upholstery looks really nice and beautiful, and you're telling the kids to be careful. And then after a while, things start happening, right? There's nicks on the windshield, and there's dents from shopping carts and in the grocery stores, and the paint starts fading a little bit more, and there's gummy bears stuck between the seats, and juice boxes have spilled, and there's some smell back there, and you're like, I may have to get a hazmat team here, because I have no idea what that is. And you get to a point where the oil's leaking, and all these different things, and you start wondering, maybe we need to trade this in for a newer model, put something different. And I think a lot of people think of marriage like that. They think, you know, it used to be really good. The best time we ever had was on our wedding day, and it's kind of been downhill. But I think marriage is not that way. I think what it really is when we get married, we are given two big boxes, and they're filled with parts. And the day you come over your honeymoon, you start pulling those parts out, and you're like, wow. You got a steering wheel, you got a door, you got a seat, you got a carburetor, you got spark plugs, all these different things, and you start going, okay, we got to start putting this together. And so you start trying to figure out what goes where, and you're not really sure. And part of the problem, too, is you've gotten things from your own family. They put stuff in the box, and so you're pulling it out, and you go, okay, we got a front end from a Honda, and the rear end of a GMC. I'm not going to say who's the rear. But we start doing that, and eventually you're going, wow, this is starting to look like a car. This is really cool. You start putting it together, and then at some point, you go, hey, let's put the key in and see if it starts up. And all of a sudden it starts up, and you're like, this is great. And then one day you're out taking it for a test drive, and you're working on it. Every day, every weekend, you're building on this thing. And then one day, as you're driving along in your automobile, people are looking, wow, look at that. That is fantastic. It's a classic. And I think that's the way marriage really works.
They just do. So it's our job to help show them how can we use this thing as a planner. So here's my guess. Board system. This is the board. So this is more for elementary kids. You can do it up into middle school for sure. The board, there's a little board here. It's about $25. You can get it at Office Max. It'll last you your entire career. But you can see that it has each day. And what we would do is this was a place to reinforce that planner. So the kids would come home and they'd have to open up their planner, even in kindergarten, and they'd have to write down or put a symbol down of what they had to get done that day. What also was up there was if they had a library that day, if they had gym that day. Because guess what? I can tell you, I never knew when my kids had gym. I never knew when my kids had library. I never put that to my memory because it's not my job to remember. Whose job was it to remember? Should I teach them to memorize it, or should I teach them to use the tool? Help them to teach to use the tool, not you, to be successful. So they would write that out, they'd see, and I might see that they don't have their gym shoes, and I could look up on the board and see that there was a gym symbol or the word gym, and I might say, have you checked your board? I didn't go and grab their gym shoes and put it in their backpack. But I'd say, go, did you check your board? Did you check your board? And they could go and look for all of the papers that would come home. But elementary parents, is that like not the most aggravating thing on the planet? A form, this, and that, and where you get something on your computer and you print it off, and where do I put it? There's a little corkboard there so you can put it. How about when you get an invitation or you have something fun coming up at church? You can put that right underneath the Sunday or Saturday. You can put down any of their practices, and they can start seeing how to plan out their life. And then they can write out what they have for homework on that board. I'm telling you, a kindergartner thinks it's the greatest thing ever. like fourth or fifth grade, and by that point, they've kind of mastered knowing how to look at their schedule. Make sense? So using a chalkboard or a whiteboard. Now for middle schoolers, you might have something that's a little different. It could be a whiteboard or it can be an easel. And they maybe have to be held accountable to getting their homework done. Anybody have middle schoolers that sometimes their homework doesn't get done? So maybe they have to put it up on the board and then they have to show it to you before it goes off. And that way, you can encourage them. You can use direct language instead of, what's your homework, what's your homework? You can look up on the board and say, oh, you have chapter 10 for homework and math. How did chapter 9 test go, right? Instead of the nay, nay, nay. For dads or moms that are coming home after they started homework, if they use that board and you start seeing things being crossed out, you feel a lot more involved and kind of helping and encouraging. You can use different